David Tangsheng Wu disappeared sometime in May. He went on the lam for months after BC's College of Dental Surgeons raided his Burnaby rental home. He was wanted for ignoring an injunction demanding he stop practicing dentistry. 1,500 of his patients were later told to get tested for potential infections.
He may have been reusing needles and other contaminated materials. Overall, there was a gross lack of basic hygiene on the premises.
So far, no one has tested positive. The college hired a private investigator, offering a $2,000 reward for anyone who would turn Wu in. None did.
He is hiding. If anybody is helping him in that regard, they should know that this is not somebody worthy of that sort of help.
This former patient says he got a great deal and had no health issues.
I don't have nothing against him, so I wish him, yes, he just can present himself and, you know, deal whatever he had to deal with.
Cost was a huge reason why Wu had so many patients. This Chinatown dentist says some of them have since gone to him because of health concerns.
But for some, you know, even though they have money, but they still don't want to spend the extra money. Sometimes they go to Mexico, or sometimes they go back to China.
Wu's van was eventually found full of supplies waiting to be shipped out of the country. In November, he turned himself into Toronto police and was shipped back to BC. Sources have told the CBC the college is looking into at least seven other known illegal dentists operating in Metro Vancouver. In October, the college raided two homes. Dental equipment was removed. So far, no charges have been laid.
For now, David Wu remains in jail. He was sentenced to 3 months, not for practicing illegal dentistry, but for violating a court order. He was also ordered to pay a $100,000 fine to the college. That's how much the college says it cost them to shut him down. Petty Fong, CBC News, Vancouver.
We just hope that Lorraine gets the justice that she deserves.
It's been a long wait for justice for the families of Charlene Reevely and Lorraine Cruz. The two victims of a horrific hit and run 3 years ago didn't even know each other. They met in February 2011 as Reevely tried to comfort Cruz with a hug at the side of Lougheed Highway. Cruz and her partner had just been in a minor car accident. The life-changing moment for both their families happened seconds later. Corey Sater was drunk when he plowed into the two women, killing them instantly.
There was no breathalyzer or blood test taken because Mr. Sater had left the scene, so that wasn't possible. So it had to rely upon the estimates of the expert.
Video evidence presented at Sater's trial helped prove he had been out drinking beforehand. Today, in convicting Sater of impaired and dangerous driving causing death, the judge said he believed the testimony of servers at the bar who cut off Sater after he had eight drinks. They testified he was drunk when he left the bar. The Reevely and Crew family say the verdict offers them some solace.
It's been a harrowing experience, and saddening for everybody. I mean, now just waiting for the sentencing. I mean, nothing's going to bring them back, but at least you get some satisfaction.
Hopefully something like this will never happen to anybody else. You don't not want to be in my shoes, okay? So I guess just have to wait for the sentencing to happen, and hopefully it's a good sentence that he gets.
The judge said Sater conducted himself in a reckless way when he chose to get behind the wheels of a vehicle that night and showed flagrant disregard for the safety of others on the highway. His sentencing hearing will begin on March 31st. Petty Fong, CBC News, New Westminster.
Eric Peterson had two chairs on his front porch. Visitors sometimes came by to listen to his stories about how False Creek once lapped up to his front yard on East 7th Avenue between Glen Drive and Windsor Street, about how much had changed. One day, a few years ago, artist Michael Kluckner visited Peterson and asked him if he could paint his old cottage.
Did he ever see the painting that you did of the house?
Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
I brought it over and he liked it. He was just this old eccentric guy who'd lived alone for so many years. And managed to look after himself right up until, he was in his late 80s.
Peterson's cottage was built in 1907. He bought it for $6,000 in 1960.
Hard to believe, but where we are right now used to be waterfront. And when the tide was right, you could take your boat from here and row all the way down to Gastown.
I think he loved the to and fro of all of the people who come here, and with the college being just next door, he enjoyed that, because otherwise he probably would have had a more of a solitary life.
Around Peterson, houses were torn down. Always resourceful, he took the scrap wood from the townhouse development next door and used that to heat his wood stove. And he was an avid collector of, well, stuff. When he died 2 years ago, his possessions included 87 car tires and piles of scrap metal. Peterson's beloved cottage was sold to a developer. Property value alone, $800,000. Neighbors worried about the fate of the historic home, but this tiny cottage will be lifted up, moved to the front with a new foundation, and two houses built behind it. And Peterson's cottage will stay right here, where the porch can host new chats about the changing city. Petty Fong, CBC News, Vancouver.